So Emmanuel Anati is going to speak about Har Karkom archaeological discoveries on a holy mountain in the desert of the Exodus. Please.
Thank you. Well, I thought that the most useful thing I could do here is just show you some of the main discoveries at Har Karkom, where we have been doing a survey for several years now. We have been excavating several sites. And what appears is, how do I move the just like that? Yes. I have written a more extensive report to be published afterwards, but at this point I think that many of you may not know exactly what we found there, although we published a schedule of all the 1,315 sites discovered in two volumes. But perhaps many people don't have access at these volumes. What so you see the landscape? How do I operate that? I'm not. I don't know exactly how to do
that. Hang on 1 second.
Thank you.
You see this button?
Oh
this
yes,
little
yes,
one?
I
just
see.
Just do that.
That's good.
Okay.
Thank you. Now, what you see here is Har Karkom, is a sort of mesa, it's a plateau. And in front of us here, all that is what Israeli maps call the Paran Desert. This is Wadi Jirafi, which is in the maps of Israel, is Nahal Paran. And this is the mountain. You can see this plateau has a fantastic landscape around, and you can visual mountains which are 75 kilometers away. So there is an overview of all the area around. This is the mountain. The plateau is has been used for living sites in the Paleolithic age, but in the Bronze Age, it has just sanctuaries and altars, and the population lived in the valleys around. Here, this is the Northern Valley, which has a great number of settlements, of living sites. Here, there are some. And here there are some, but most of the living sites are concentrated in this area. And you see the edge of the mountain is quite difficult to access beside three points, and this is one of the points. You see there is an ancient trail that goes up, and there are two more areas which are easy to reach. And then in recent days, more of these trails have been produced by visitors, but most of the mountain is difficult to access to the plateau. Now, what you see here are breaks of large pieces of stone that fall down. And this is something that characterize this mountain, so that the normal way of calling it for us, for the team working there, we call it Har Chorev, which is a Hebrew name for Har Sinai, for Mount Sinai, but it is a mountain which just is collapsing, is getting apart, and this is what you see there, all this. While we are at work there, sometimes at night we hear like explosions, And these are pieces of rocks that fall down. This is what you see. There are cracks all around. And from time to time, pieces are falling apart. What you see here is a huge fire. And this is what characterizes the mountain. This area of fire is about 25 meters long. And there are several such places on the mountain. Now you see these cracks that you see here are typical of fire. And we found in certain areas like this one, it is full of these rocks with cracks, which indicate the presence of ancient fires. And sometimes there are pillars near these areas of fire. Now, one of the characteristics of this plateau. Pardon? Somebody asked me a question. No. Maybe just oh, yes. Yes, you see, are these geoglyphs. You can see here a human being. This animal is over 30 meters long. Very large animals here. There are about 25 or 26 of these geoglyphs on the mountain. And the top of the mountain is just what we call the breast, because it looks like a female breast, the top of the mountain. There are two tops, which you can see there here from the air. One top is long, and it has here a standing stone, a pillar. And the other is in the middle, has a little cave at the top of the mountain. To the best of my knowledge, I have been working for many years surveying Sinai and the Negev, and this is the only mountain I know where there is a small cave on top of the mountain, which, we have from the Bible, the Nikra Basela, the little cave on top of the mountain, which is quite strangely corresponding here. Now, there is water on this mountain, which is rather unique. And my team, my students come here to swim in May and June after 3 months that there was not a drop of rain falling from the sky. Now, there are trails, which may be ancient trails, and there are rock carvings like this one along the trails. But some of these rock carvings on the trails that lead to the mountain are praying figure, just worshippers. We don't know what they are worshiping because this is a strange mark, but they are worshiping something. And we find that along the trails that lead to the mountain. Now this, for instance, this one probably was standing and now is fallen down. Unfortunately, some of these praying people along the trails have been stolen. They are missing. I don't know. In Israel, many people like to be collectioners, and this is just going to some private gardens. But luckily, we recorded everything, so we know exactly what we have to find, even if things are missing, but the recording is there. Now, this is the type of plateau that we have here. And as I said, most of the living sites are around, while on top of the mountain, there is some Paleolithic sites. But down below, you can see here there are three periods. This is early Bronze Age. Here there are two circular houses that are the end of the early Bronze Age, EB4 and Middle Bronze I. And here are Roman structures. So you can see how these settlements around the mountain are covering different periods. Now the Paleolithic is, now this mountain has a very peculiar thing that it was excavated by the wind. There are very dry periods, there have been very dry periods in which the wind cleaned everything. And when we get to a Paleolithic site like this one, you see all this is so-called hamada, is just the heavy material which the wind was unable to take away. But all the sand and the lus and the light elements have been cleaned off. And now in a place like that, we find, you see there are even trails leading from one hut to the other. There is a fireplace here. There is a flint workshop over here. And we find the flint workshop with the flakes spread all over a certain place. And the fireplace is still with a few stones around. So it is something, when you do an excavation, you have a few square meters excavated. And here we have just hectares excavated by the wind. So all the surface is a fantastic open air museum. Now you see the flakes here, this is a core. And the flakes is just on the opposite side. You can still see how people have worked this material, and things have remained where they were left 30 or 40,000 years ago. Now, here you can see one of these Paleolithic settlements. This is a site of the beginning of the early Bronze Age, of the late Paleolithic. And here, nearby, there is a sort of cluster of standing stones, which appear to be some sort of sanctuary, very early. And then, from the sanctuary, there is a trail, very dangerous trail, leading down to the Paran Desert. You can see this trail here, which is just consider that here there are nearly 100 meters, and you have to walk like that and then turn down again. And this is probably a trail which was used in very early times. Now, you can see the standing stones. Now, this site have been have attracted curious people and they have moved the stones. But by the excavation of the site, we could recognize whole of the stones on the fossil soil so that we know where these stones were standing by, and we hope to reconstruct it. You can see this sort of natural shapes of stones where only the ice have been added by man. People just found these natural stones, gathered them in one spot, and just made a few things. But you see, this gives you an example of how these stones have been fixed inside the soil with little stones to stick them well together. And on the surface, which is also a fossil surface, you can see that there are some alignments of flint implements, probably some very primitive geoglyphs which belong to the same period. Now, some of these stones have been chipped around to give them a shape, and they are all concentrated in the same area where we found about 40 figurines, again, almost natural, because you see here, the nose was shaped, here there is a flake, here there is a flake, the eye was engraved. And these figurines are found just near the standing stones. You see here the eyes and the mouth of whatever. Here there's a feminine figurine. with the engraving here. Here there is a sort of bird with the nose engraved and the eyes. And here a stag or something like that. This is the material culture found in this site, which is early Upper Paleolithic. And this is another site of later Upper Paleolithic, a Gravettian site, which you can almost recognize how people lived 25,000 years ago with a hut which was bigger than the others. Here there is the workshop. We excavated only 12 square meters and found there quite a lot of flint implements, over 5,000 flint implements. And here there is something very strange. There are two circles of pole holes, which you see here in the which is likely to have been a sort of cult or social place. Now, from the Neolithic period, we have just one site which may be considered to be a sanctuary. This is a round circle with a black stone here in front of the entrance, which is square, probably a sort of altar. And here on this rock, there is a human face engraved, which you can see here. Now, these early sanctuaries here are just the premise for an explosion of cult sites in the Bronze Age. We call it BAC, Bronze Age Complex, which is a Bronze Age of Chalcolithic tradition, typical to the Negev and Sinai. The only structure on the plateau is a sort of little temple, which you see here, and this is the plan. There is a closed room. Here there was a pole, so the surface of this area probably was covered by skin or I don't know what. There is here a sort of platform looking east, but looking to the top of the mountain also. And here the entrance. We excavated this a trench on this temple or whatever. And you see here it is full of stones, but here there is an empty area of stones, a hole which was excavated below the surface of the temple. And here there are stones put vertical, just hidden below the surface, the stepping surface of this sort of sanctuary. Here it's another kind of monuments that we find there, which is a sort of so-called Gal Ed. It is a tumulus, which is not a burial, but inside there is a sort of altar. And there is remains of burning around the altar. And then after whatever they did was finished, it was covered, and there was a tumulus of stones on top of this altar and remains of burning. Now, one of these tumuli, it is in the most prominent edge of the mountain. Here you see the Paran Desert all the way to the Dead Sea. And this was also excavated. And we found in the middle of this heap a rectangular stone, natural shape. On top of it, there was this sort of half circle of half moon with a few flint implements nearby. Just again, there is a heap of stones that were put on top of an altar. And in this case, on top of the altar, there was a sort of a white piece of stones, which is heavy, 44 kilos, with a few early Bronze Age flint implements nearby. Now, on the surrounding area, oh, I see. So I have to rush. On the surrounding area of the mountain, there are a few sanctuaries. One of these is a spiral sanctuary. We found about 16 of them. You can see one here again. You see, it's a spiral. And what is there is an entrance somewhere, and the circle. And then in the middle, there is a standing stone and a little altar with remains of fireplace. Here there is another fireplace. Another of such spirals with a standing stone, again a sort of altar in front, and the fireplace. Now there are, I will rush because I'm told that I don't have much time left. Here you can see it's a group of 12 standing pillars in half a circle. 12 is a recurring number. Here there are 12 pillars in front of an altar. On this floor, there are incrustations of early Bronze Age flint implements. And on the altar, there is a sort of sacrificial stone. Now, there are many so-called private sanctuaries, private shrines, which are just all over the mountain, and standing stones. Some of the standing stones have just trails leading to it. Here you can see a standing stone with ice, engraved ice and mouth. Here there is something very strange, a sort of ram, standing ram. You can see the leg, the horns, the muzzle. Well, this is, and here a face with a sort of antelope engraved on the front. Here you can see it. You can see it here. There are many anthropomorphic figures. This was found just standing on top of an altar, and there are also platforms with, you see, there is an altar here, and this is a huge platform, 18 meters large. You can see it from the air. There are three different platforms. Here is the village, and nearby these sort of platforms. This is the material culture that goes together. Now, around the mountain, there are the plaza sites, which are very typical, just a few huts in a circle. And you can see the location of the plaza sites all around the mountain. Another other plaza sites. Near the only source of water, which is the Bear Karkom, which you see. This is the source of water. There is a defense. There is a sort of fortress, early Bronze Age also, in which we found also a small alabaster vase of Egyptian origin. And to finish, just the presence of a tremendous concentration of rock art. You see different periods with different kinds of patina. Most people see easily the later phase. This is probably calcolithic, but they don't recognize easily the early phase, which you can see here, which is below, and it has patina almost identical to that of the third. The stratigraphy allows to recognize different periods. This is a chariot of the late Bronze Age. This is an ox, which is earlier than that, and these are figures which are later than that. Harp, musical instruments that relate to archaeological findings. This is from the Uvda Valley, not far away from Karkom. This early Bronze Age site has here a fireplace, and near the fireplace, an engraved rock with the footprints and an animal was found, the same that we found on the mountain, the footprints and the, well, I could go on and on, but I think I have to stop. We're in a hurry.
We're not in a hurry, but you'd have to stop. Yeah, well, that's what we have to do, because I'm leaving 5 minutes now for discussion, because I believe you've suggested that this could be Mount Sinai, correct?
Yes.
So maybe you could say some words about that, and then we'll have some more discussion.
Well, I have been puzzled myself by this mountain. When I found this mountain, I was a student. I was doing the first archaeological survey ever done in the Negev in 1953-54. And I immediately fell in love with this mountain. It talked to me. There was something very strong that, and then I was taken away because I was at Harvard, and then I was in Oxford, and then I was 7 years in Paris. And when I could go back doing field research in 78, I wanted to go back to this mountain. But it was lost because there was no, the names were changed. The Bedouins were no more there. And I couldn't find this Jebel Idait, was the previous name, which means the mountain of the festivities, of the mountain of the meetings, which is a strange name anyhow for a mountain in the desert. And then in 1980, I found this mountain again, and since then we have been, we got a concession from the Antiquities Department, and we have done an extensive survey, bringing back to our knowledge 1,315 archaeological sites, where not a single site was known before. Now, the mountain is a sacred mountain in the middle of nowhere with altars and shrines and whatever else. You have seen just a small part of it, but it is, we have a report published in 2 volumes on the schedule of the findings at the mountain. You can see it if you wish. And it is a holy mountain in the middle of the desert, in the desert of Exodus. Well, if it is not Mount Sinai, I think it is unlikely that such a mountain with this tremendous quantity of worship places was ignored by the Pentateuch. And if it is not Mount Sinai, what would have been the name given in the Bible to this site? Now, this was the first question we asked ourselves. And then we did a lot of work on the geographical history of the area, and we came to the conclusion that this was the right spot for locating Mount Sinai. Big problem is that there is nothing related to the late Bronze Age. It is all early Bronze Age and the beginning of the middle Bronze Age. So if this is Mount Sinai, the dates of Exodus accepted so far are wrong, or if they are right, this is not Mount Sinai.
Okay, good. Thank you. Would somebody like to ask a question? Bill Deaver.
this is, of course, interesting, but not unique. I mean, these kinds of structures are found by Uzi Avner and others all over the Negev, and so there are many other similar Mount Sinais. I don't know why one would pick this one.
Yes, Diver, I'm grateful for your question, because Uri Avner and other people found early Neolithic sites, 7,000 BC. This is the only sacred site of the Bronze Age, not only in the Negev, but in the entire Sinai Peninsula. This is the difference, you see. And besides that, all the other candidates to Mount Sinai have no evidence of people that stopped at the foot of the mountain. And here we have hundreds of gathering places of the Bronze Age. People coming in, masses of people were coming in pilgrimage or whatever around this mountain. So these are two main differences. We just had a meeting on Karkom a couple of weeks ago in the Negev at Mitzper Amon, and Uri Avner was there, and we discussed this point. He puts everything in the same pot, but you have to consider the periods, which are different. And this is the only Bronze Age site.
Okay, thank you. Let's give him another hand, please. And we can all go to coffee and be back here for 10:30. Thank you.